Way. We go through this every single time. Good morning, Eagles Way.
I don't think you're on.
You'll be on in a second. Is it unmuted? Yep. Are you ready for the cookout today? Come on, good food, good fun. You ready for the cookout today?
Yeah.
All right. This week, I've been thinking, it's funny how life just makes you think about just random things. And anybody in here is a parent to a little under 9 years old little boy, like you know my struggle. You know, homework's a big thing. You gotta be in shape to do homework with these little kids. You have to be. Chad, he tries me. So we sit down and I say, hey Chad, gonna do your spelling words, give him one. I gave him one word, I said, all right, spell wrong. He looked at me and he said, W-R-O-N-G. I said, wait, what? W-R-O-N-G. Well, write it. He wrote it. And it was spelled right, but he kept saying W-R-O-N-G. And I said, well, it's wrong, but it's right, but it's not. I want you to tell your mom, when the mom gets home, Sheena gets home, I passed it off. She gets home, Chad spelled wrong, W-R-O-N-G. Like, that's not what he said earlier. That's not what he said. You got to be in shape. This kid, they'll try you. But, you know, we think about wrong. I grew up in the church, and I've been around a lot of churches that I felt like did things the wrong way. My dad's Uncle Gus lost his arm in a fight in a church parking lot. That was wrong. But wrong. I was reading on the news where two people got into a fight or somebody got shot after church for sitting in the wrong seat. No, really, you can't make this stuff up. It's on the news. So if anybody is sitting in that seat, the second one, if it's yours, just let me know. I'll move. No problems whatsoever. I'm in a church that did things, say, we do things differently. And the problem with different is when you do something different and people like it, a lot of other people start doing those things as well, so it's not really different anymore. But what I like about being here at Eagles Way is we always do things right. It's always done the right way. And in my coming up on 3 years being here, wow, time flies, I've always felt like this has been the place for me. This has been the right place to be. You know, you see what I did there? Right place to be. If you come here and you're broken, there's a place here. We build you up. You know, I think when I was first here, we put a post up and it was, church is not a museum for perfect people. It's a hospital for broken people. You know, we build people up. If there are things you want to work on in your life, this is the right place to be. You may feel like you're in that perfect place in your walk with God. And you know what? We got room for you here too as well. You know, there's place for you. So I just want to take the time today to just welcome you guys to Eagles Way Church, the place that I feel like this is the place to be. So I want to welcome you guys and stand and worship with us.
Of your
Savior alone carried the cross for all of my debts. He paid the cost. Salvation complete and forever I'm free. Calvary covers it all. Calvary covers it all. My sin and shame don't count anymore. All praise to the one who has ransomed my soul. Calvary covers it all. No power.
Thank you. have the sweetest of love, when my heart becomes green and my shame is
I'm I just want to take a minute and breathe for just a second. We tend to rush these songs together to try to make it flow, and it's just this moment is really, really great. This week for me has been about trying to get calm. And every morning I spent kind of purposefully meditating and not putting a time limit on it and just breathing for a second. And it's so powerful when you don't have an agenda. Now, my life isn't always like that. I'm busy a lot and have a lot of things to do, but this week just lined up perfect, and I just saw God in kind of a different way. I accidentally, just kind of randomly, found myself in Acts, and a scripture I've heard 1,000 times and never had any idea what it was talking about is when it says that your young people will have visions and your older people will dream dreams. And that just always sounds like weird talk to me. But as I took a moment and as I breathed and as I meditated and I didn't have an agenda, for just a brief second, I saw God as this wind that was moving through me, and it was moving through Eagle's Way, and I saw myself as the way God sees me for like just a second. It was like 2 seconds. Right now, when I lift my hands today, I'm holding up calmness, and I'm holding up my heavy agenda, and I'm just saying, God, this is yours. Give me a little piece of that. And if you're comfortable, you can lift up the thing in your life that's keeping you afraid, and if you're not comfortable, just hold it in your mind's eye. If you're the provider for your house, and you're afraid that you're not gonna have enough, just grab that in your mind's eye or grab it in your hands and hold it up. If you're afraid for your marriage or relationship, grab it in your mind's eye and hold it up. And just let it breathe, because what it's going to be is bigger than what you think it is. And there's a wind that's gonna blow that directly to God. There's an energy that's going to take that away from you, and it's going to control that for you, and you're just going to reap the benefits of it all the time. The more broken and the more powerless that we are, the bigger the energy is that can take that away from us. So if you feel broken and you feel powerless, you're exactly the spot to where everything can be taken away from you, and what's good can be brought back to you. And you can see it if you're quiet and you're calm.
Never-ending. Your love is never failing. God, you go above and beyond any of our wildest dreams and imaginations, Father. Relationships you restore. You build us up, God. You support us. Father, all the things that you do, Lord, we could never thank you enough, God. Thank you for allowing us love. Thank you for showing us your spirit and allowing us to inhabit all that you have done for us, God. We praise you and we thank you, Jesus, for your goodness and your faithfulness. Oh, God, you are so beautiful. Thank you for your spirit. Amen.
Thank you. These guys good or not? You know, when I say good, I'm not talking about their talents. I'm talking about their hearts. Because their hearts mean more than their talents. And we're going to be closing out this service this morning talking about worshiping God in spirit and in truth. And I want to show you biblically why they do that. They do that. Isn't that good? Couple of things before I get started this one. Number one, this Wednesday night is our first Wednesday service. I want to encourage you to be here. Our youth are going to be here with us for the next couple, 3 months. We're going to be talking about the gifts of the Holy Spirit from 1 Corinthians chapter 12. So if you have been interested in what those gifts are about and how to personalize them in your life, we're going to be sharing about that. Holly, our children's pastor, graduated this week with a master in media specialist. So when you see her at the cookout, you can congratulate her. But I want to pray this morning for two things. I want to pray for me and I want to pray for you. So Father, I just ask you, God, to, you always help us, but I ask you, Lord, for special help today. Special anointing, whatever it is that we need to communicate what you've placed in our heart. I ask you, God, for the listeners, that our ears be fully open, our hearts be open wide to receive from you today what we need to receive so that we can know you better. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. Dusty called me the other day. She asked me how to advertise this morning's service on Facebook and social media, what title to put on the message. And I said, wow, that's a good question, because I don't really have a title. I don't know how to really put this into words. But if I could, and I want to take our word grasp, how to grasp our being. And we took those five words, and we'll be talking about those some this month, about giving, renewing, attending, serving, and praying. But I want to make this statement and then get into some scriptures about God and who is this unknown God. And I want to talk about this morning, I guess it was, I could say it this way, to grasp our true being, we've got to grasp the true God. If we're going to grasp our true being, then we got to grasp the true God. And in Acts chapter 17, verse 16, he says, while Paul was waiting for them in Athens, he was deeply troubled by all the idols he saw everywhere in the city. And he went to the synagogue to reason with the Jews and the God-fearing Gentiles, and he spoke daily in the public square to all who happened to be there. He was deeply troubled because he saw all these means and ways of trying to find God. And he was deeply troubled how they were doing that. Now, we don't have a Mars Hill, but we have a Taylor Street, and a 6th Street, and all the streets and the neighborhoods. And I guarantee you that every week you'd find a group of people who are in debates about who this God is. And you'd have a Baptist God, a Methodist God, a Pentecostal God, a Catholic God, Charismatic God, a Pentecostal God. But I want to tell you, God's way above all of that. He's a God that you can grasp and understand in an awesome way. But then he said he also had a debate with some of the Epicurean and Stoic philosophers. The Epicurean and Stoic. And these were people who really were seeking. I want you to hear, they really are seeking for truth. But the Epicureans, they believed that everything happened by chance. Death was the end of everything. God does not care. And pleasure is the chief end of mankind. Death is all there is. Once you die, there's nothing else. They believe that. They believe God doesn't care. I'd be an Epicurean if I believed that. That sounds like an Epicurean, doesn't it? They don't believe that God cares. Now, the Stoics had really a good understanding, but there was some things missing. They believed everything was God. God was a fiery spirit. They were a spark of that spirit that gave them life. And when they died, it returned to God. Now, what they believed there is so true, because Ecclesiastes says that when we die, our body returns to the earth from which it came, but our spirit returns to God from which it came. And so here they also believe something else. They believe that every so often the earth went up in a ball of fire and everything was consumed and God started all over again. There's a little bit of that still creeping through. There's a little bit of that still coming in. I do believe that we are a spark from Him. I do believe that we are here on this earth to make a difference and to be who God says we are and to see lives change because of who we are. He says, when he told them about Jesus and his resurrection, they said, what's this babbler trying to say with these strange ideas he's picked up? Others said he seems to be preaching about some foreign gods. They took him to the high council of the city. Now, let me back up. The reason they thought he was a babbler when he talked about it, because he was bringing God here. He was bringing God too close. He was bringing, Jesus was came to reveal who God is. And so they didn't really want this closest. They wanted a God way out here, but not here. You with me? Yeah. As long as God was out here, then he's not here, then all is well. It's like when the Israelites, when Moses was getting the commandments and God was speaking and there was fire and there was shaking, they were afraid and they said to Moses, listen, next time God wants to talk, let him talk to you. And then you come tell us what he said, because we don't want this personal thing. It's just too close. It's too close. And so they took him to the high council of the city. Come and tell us about this new teaching. You are saying some rather strange things. And we want to know what it's all about. I'll come back to that. It should be explained that all the ones for Athens, as well as the foreigners, seem to spend all their time discussing the latest ideas. Standing before the council addressed them as follows. Men of Athens, I noticed you're very religious in every way. For as I was walking along, I saw your many shrines, and one of your altars had this inscription on it, to the unknown God. This God, whom you worship without knowing, is the one I'm telling you about. He's the God who made the world and everything in it. Since he is the Lord of heaven and earth, he doesn't live in man-made temples, and human hands can't serve his needs, for he has no needs. He himself gives life and breath to everything, and he satisfies every need. From one man, he created all the nations throughout the whole earth. He decided beforehand when they should rise and fall and determine their boundaries. His purpose was for the nations to seek after God and perhaps feel their way toward him and find him, though he is not far from any of us. For in him we live and move and exist or have our being. And some of your own poets have said, we are his offspring. Since this is true, we shouldn't think of God as an idol designed by craftsmen from gold or silver, or stone. Four things he said about this unknown God. He created everything. He guides all of history. Man was created, every person was created with an instinctive longing for him. No matter where you are, where you're born, what country you live in, what African nation you're part of, you're in the deepest, darkest part of the world, there is instinctively in you a longing for this God. You go to any village in any place, there is something there. There's something going on there that's causing these people to seek after a God. It's a longing in their heart. And in Him we live and move and we have our being, or we have our existence. Life is, let me back up. Webster's, there was a deterioration of the word existence from the time this was written. That when this was written, existence, the word existence meant this in the Greek. It meant a life of purpose, a life of pleasure, a life of fulfillment, a life of hope, a life of being overwhelmed by the presence and the majesty of God. That's what existence meant. Webster's dictionary defines existence now. It has deteriorated to mean this: to live at an inferior level or under adverse circumstances, and to just live from one day to the next. It's like you ask some people today, how are you? I'm just existing. And what they're saying is, I don't have nothing going for me. I have no purpose. I have no hope. I'm just existing. No. Existing means we want to be absorbed by God. Revelations chapter 4. God help me with this. There's two words over the last 2 years that I've tried to eliminate from my vocabulary in the context that I'm about to say. And those two words are, and I would encourage you to do the same, two words to eliminate from your vocabulary when you're talking with people and you're in conversations and you're learning and you're growing. Two words: don't say, I know. The moment you say, I know, you have shut off all illumination and revelation that could come out of that conversation. Yes, sir. If you'll just say, wow, that's good. Tell me more. You'll be amazed what doors of revelation that will open up when we communicate, because we don't ever say to each other, oh, I know that. We just open up our hearts and minds and communicate more and go, wow, that's good. And as we do that, illumination and revelation opens more and more and more and more. Amen. Because you don't say, I know. That's it. I was sharing this on our vacation with the family, drinking coffee one morning. And Dusty said, Daddy, you raised me that way. You would not let me say, I know. Good. So when my mother would say something to me and you would say, I know, you would say, don't say I know, just say yes, ma'am. Because what's wrong with society today is everybody knows. Everybody's got the solution. Everybody's got the answer. I know. No, you don't know. You don't know. We are in the process of knowing. We are in the process of learning. We're in the process. I thought about the movie Avatar. It's one of my favorite movies. Kind of a weird movie, but it's a good movie. And that's me. I'm weird anyway. So in this movie, the Avatar is a human who some way they transform them into a Na'vi. And the Na'vis, they live in this place where they think they are lower thinking people. In actuality, they're far advanced. They are so far advanced above all, and one thing, they appreciated everything that was there. They appreciated all of creation. And this avatar, which they learned he was an avatar, not really a Na'vi, the avatar said, was trying to win them over, and he said, you know, I just want to be part of you, and I want to learn from you. I want you to teach me. And the Na'vi looked at the avatar and said, you cannot fill a cup that's already full. You think you know it all.
That's it, my friend.
You can't learn anything when you think you know. Then I looked and I saw a door standing open in heaven. He doesn't want to close the door. He doesn't want the door shut. He wants the door open. Because out of heaven comes all the glories and the understanding and the wisdom of God. I heard the same voice I have heard before speak to me like a trumpet blast. The voice said, come up here. I'll show you what must happen after this. And I instantly was in the spirit, and I saw a throne in heaven and someone sitting on it. The one sitting on the throne was as brilliant as gemstones, like jasper and carnelian. And the glow of an emerald circled his throne like a rainbow. And 24 thrones surrounded him, and 24 elders sat on them. They were all clothed in white and had gold crowns on their heads. From the throne came flashes of lightning and rumbles of thunder. In front of the throne were seven torches with burning flames. This is the sevenfold Spirit of God. In Revelation chapter 5, it says, and he had seven eyes, and the seven eyes were the seven spirits of God. Because you can't describe God in a statement. And you go to Isaiah chapter 11, you'll see seven aspects of the Holy Spirit and who this Spirit is. We don't have time to go to that. But in front of the throne was a shiny sea of glass, sparkling like crystal in the center. And around the throne were four living beings, each covered with eyes, front and back. The front of these living beings was like a lion. The second was like an ox. The third like a human face. And the fourth was like an eagle in flight. Each of these living creatures had six wings, and their wings were covered all over with eyes, inside and out. Let me just stop. I'm tired. You know, we've gone through this a lot here, I love what you shared last time, Ken, about the book of Revelation. I'm seeing it also in a different light. It's more like a gospel. It's just a furtherness of the gospel of God. It's just telling you more who Christ is. And when I read all of this, I'm seeing, what is all this? Why is John, what does all this mean? I don't really know what all of it means, but I know that it has to do with something about, I just want you to know this is this supreme being called God. There's just so much to him. That these things are describing this indescribable God. These things are describing this awesome, mighty, magnificent being. And it says that day after day, night after night, they keep on saying, holy, holy is the Lord God, the Almighty, the one who always was and is and is still to come. And whenever these living beings give glory and honor and thanks to the one sitting on the throne, the one who lives forever and ever. The 24 elders fall down and worship the one sitting on the throne and the one who lives forever and ever. And they lay their crowns before the throne and say, you're worthy, O Lord our God, to receive glory and honor and power, for you created all things, and they exist because you created what you pleased. These beings, 24 hours a day, are bowing before this throne. And I've said before years ago, I believe that the reason they would bow and they would come up, and when they did, they saw a whole new dimension of him, and they would just cry, holy, 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 and they'd bow back down, and they'd come back up, and they'd see a whole new dimension of him. Go, oh, and they can do this 24 hours a day, not just in a moment, not just on a Sunday morning, not just on a, oh, but we're talking day and night, 24 hours a day, day and night, every second, every minute, bowing before this awesome, unbelievable being and seeing a dimension of him they've never seen before and saying, holy. But then they say something about him. He's the one who was, who is, and is to come. The God, the true God that we serve is a God in my life who was. He's a God who is. I know him today in this dimension, and a God who will be different. Someone several years ago came to me, and they had been gone from a church for like 20-something years, and they said, Baron, it's so different. It's not what it used to be. Thank God. Really? It's not supposed to be. It's not supposed to be. I'm loving my grandkids. I'm loving my, just loving getting a second chance to raise some kids right. And getting a second chance to be able to see things differently than how I saw Dusty. And I don't see a five-year-old yet. I see a five-year-old God. I see an 11-year-old Anna, a God. I see a 13-year-old John Henry, a God. I see a God in them. I see who they really are and how much they really mean to this planet. Barbara journals and she writes and she prophesies about her kids and her grandkids. And about a year and a half ago, she wrote in her journal, she prophesied about John DeJet and said, he will change people's lives. He will change people's lives. And his teacher sent home his report card this past week, and Dusty read it, and she put a note in there, and it said, he's more than ready for the first grade. He has changed my life. Wow. If a five-year-old can change somebody's life, what are you doing? What are you doing? What am I doing? What are we doing? Can it really be happening? But you know what? I love everything about him. But in 10 years from now, if you come to my house and Jet's there, and his head's buried in that computer again, and if he's just all in his own little world to himself, and he's being the five-year-old Jet that we love so much at 15, you're going to go, No. It'd be a different. I want to go back to Acts. And I want to challenge you. I'm going to challenge me. I hadn't done this in a while. I want to challenge you, church. I want to challenge you. When they heard Paul speak about the resurrection of the dead, some laughed in contempt. Others said, we want to hear about this later. They ended Paul's discussion. But some joined him, became believers. Among them was somebody, a member of the council, a woman named Damaris, and others with him. It happens every day. People hear this, who they really are, and try to tell somebody who they really are in God. Really? In contempt? I don't believe that. Sarah, you're going to have a child. I'm 75 years old. I'm going to have pleasure at 75. I don't believe that. Thank God she was convinced of it. Yep. People laugh it off all the time. Yep. It's too good to be true. I don't believe that. Some, I put it off to later. I procrastinate it. I'll talk to you later about it. You know, Ken, you're not going to win an army today with what you're doing, but you're going to change a lot of people's lives for the good, because everybody's not going to go, oh, yeah, they're going to say, eat no bread? Really? Lay off the sugar? Really? And keep going on their way. Some are going to say, I'm going to do it. I've said for the last 3 weeks, I'm going to start back exercising Monday morning. So I'm trying to be accountable to y'all. Don't you dare say anything to me. but I'm being accountable. 3 weeks I've said, every Sunday I'm going to start back exercising Monday morning. How many know if tomorrow never comes? Do you know that tomorrow never really comes? Because when tomorrow comes, guess what it is? Okay. And you know yesterday is never really yesterday? You know all I really have is today? Because in the morning it's going to be today. And this afternoon it's going to be today. So if I'm going to get something done, I'm going to get it done today. Or it ain't going to get done. Today is the day of salvation. Don't put it off. Today. Two thieves, Jesus crucified in between the thief of the past and the thief of the future. They'll rob from you day in and day out. Your past and your future will rob from you because you keep grieving over the past and hoping for the future and not living in the present. In closing, John chapter 4, Jesus encounters a woman of Samaria, a Samaritan that nobody would have anything to do with. And in this thing that happened, one of the greatest stories probably in the Gospels, one of the greatest stories, this story has been told for years over and over and over. It's a beautiful, magnificent, awesome story. And Jesus comes to get water because he's thirsty, and this woman comes. And Jesus, in this conversation with her, he says, if you knew who I was, who was talking to you, you would ask me to give you water. Yeah. And she looked at him and went, you don't even have a bucket. You don't even have a bucket. How can you give me water? And you can't dive down there and get it. You got to have a bucket. I mean, no, people always got an excuse. You don't have a bucket. I'm going to tell you something. I got some water that you'll drink. You'll never thirst again. It's a water that will be in you, bubbling up always. 19, sir, the woman said, you must be a prophet. So tell me, why is that you Jews insist Jerusalem is the only place of worship, while we Samaritans claim that it's here at Mount Gerizim, where our ancestors worshiped? Jesus replied, believe me, dear woman, the time is coming, and when it will no longer matter where you worship the Father, on this mountain or in Jerusalem. You Samaritans know very little about the one you worship. I could go a long way there, but I'm not. While we Jews know all about him, for salvation comes to the Jews. What Jesus is saying, the reason I know and the Jews know is because I am him. But the time is coming indeed and is here now when true worshipers will worship the Father in spirit and in truth. For the Father is looking for those who will worship him that way. For God is spirit, and they who worship him must worship in spirit and in truth. The woman said, I know. I know. Let's just, I'm going to pause there for a minute because I want to get this nailed down. I know. Do you really? I know the Messiah is coming, the one who is called Christ. When he comes, he'll explain everything to us. I am the Messiah. I am him. The Samaritans lived in Jerusalem. And so they thought, well, if we're going to be a part of Jerusalem, we probably need to be a part of their God, right? I mean, we probably need to worship their God, don't you think? So being we're here, we're going to believe in him. And they did. And they believed in the first five books of the Bible, the Pentateuch, and that was it. They wouldn't read Isaiah. They wouldn't read any other part. They wouldn't believe any other part but the first five books. I had meditating about that, Ron John. I thought, that sounds like to me selective worship. Chooses what it wishes to know about God and omits the rest. Come to a place, J.D., where they choose what they want to believe about God, and they come to that place, they know what they know that know, and they want to stop right there. I'm going to choose this as selective worship. Choose what I want to know about God. And Mary remembered years ago there was a guy in our church, and I won't call his name, but you'll remember him. He always sat in the back, and he would say, amen, two times in the service, every Sunday morning, two times. Never knew when it was coming. It would come at the most inopportune time, at the most inappropriate time, but he was going to get his two amens in. Amen. Just like that. He was character. And he had some strange ideas. I mean, he was a weird fellow. His wife told him one time, said, you love that TV more than you love me. He says, well, I'll show you I don't. Grabbed the TV, opened the back door, and threw it out. I was talking, preaching one day, and I said, Noah was a preacher of righteousness. And he came up to me after the service, Will. He said, the Bible didn't say anything about Noah was a preacher of righteousness. And I said, Peter said he was a preacher of righteousness. What does Peter know? He wasn't back there. He's serious. It's a heart attack. And I looked at him, and I said, I'm about to call his name. I said, have you ever read the New Testament? I ain't got through the Old Testament yet. True. He said, I hadn't even got a grip of the Old Testament. I said, my God, son, just do away with the Old. Get you a New Testament. You'll be fine. You'll be so much better off if you get to know the true God. What does it mean to worship him in spirit and in truth? It means you worship him with an affectionate heart and an enlightened mind. An affectionate heart and an enlightened mind. That's truth and spirit. I was watching over the last years a group of young people who took the stage and led us in praise and worship. They've just grown up doing this. And every one of them, the players, every one of the singers, I watch them. And they come from an affectionate heart. They play their instruments with an affectionate heart. And that's why I'll fight you over one of them. I will fight you over one of them because they lead you in spirit and in truth. See, it ain't the style of music. You can have any style you want to have. That's not what worship's all about. Worship is not about style. Worship is about feeling. Worship is about a heart. Worship is about having an affectionate calling out to God, and you're worshiping him in spirit and in truth. And let me tell you something, there are three musts in the Bible that you must do. You must be born again. You must come back to the original person that you really were. You must come back to being born from where you came from. Gosh, you're more than two people got to get that. You got to be born again. It's like, I'm getting saved. I'm not going to hell. I'm going to heaven. No, no, no. You're coming back to who you really are, to the original purpose of being that you came from. You came from God. Whew. You came from God. You must be born again, he says, and the Son of Man must be lifted up from the earth. I got to be crucified so I can bring this thing about. And you must worship in spirit and truth. I don't care how low it is, how high it is, how loud it is, how quiet it is. It better come from the heart. Better come from the heart. Barbara, let me do it like this from way back here. I would, but you know, I can look at Barbara and I can say, and we do this a lot of times. I love you. Love you too. That's cool. I like that. I hang up. I don't talk with Dusty. We're on the phone. I say, I love you. Love you too. I even said that to Ron John. We're on the phone. Love you, man. Love you too. And that's cool. But there's something different when I wrap my arms around Barbara and I look in her eyes and say, I love you. I love you. Something more affectionate about that, more passionate about that, more meaningful about that. And see, that's what worship in spirit and truth means. Is when you get to the Greek, it means that you worship God face to face. Face to face. You worship him face to face. It's the action of the new nature. Love this. Seeking as the sparks fly upward to return to the divine and heavenly source from which it came. E.D. gonna come out. Emil, that one. That one. Wow. It's coming face to face with the God, acknowledging our genesis in him, that he is our delight. It's a celebration of our redemption. It's a celebration of our redemption. It's coming back. See, Sunday mornings, I believe, is really pretty simple. It's getting realigned. It's coming, reminding ourselves who we are, where we came from, so that I can go out this week and be that. I can be that out there. I can be it. Not do it, be it. And it's three things. You want to grasp the true God? And I'll close with this. You ready? You want to grasp the true God? Be a giver. Not a taker. Go give. Renew. Attend to things you need to attend to. Serve. Be a servant. And pray for people. You see a person sin to sin, it's not unto death. Pray that God forgive them and give them life for that. Instead of criticizing and judging people who do wrong, why don't you just ask God to forgive them? That's what you're here for. You see what they did? God forgive them. Intercede for them. So I tell Barbara, if you just forgive me, if when you just see me mess, just if you just look at me and say, God, forgive that loving man. Forgive that person. Just speak that. I was laying in bed the other night, and I was thinking about this. I thought I was going to preach on giving this morning. So I was thinking about giving. I was meditating. And I had this thought come to me. And I knew it wasn't me. It had come somewhere else. I really believe God spoke to me and said, you know that I didn't institute giving? You know I didn't institute the tithe? I said, what? What you talking about? He said, go back and read it. And I went back and I read in Genesis, Dusty. God didn't tell Abraham to give a tenth of everything. Abraham just won a battle that was so mighty in his life, and it meant so much to him and his family and a bunch of other people, that he gave a tenth to Melchizedek, the high priest. God didn't ever say a word about that. He came up with that himself, Terry. He came up with that himself. And you know what? God said, that's a good idea. Y'all ain't hear me. Y'all hear me? God, that's a good idea. Why didn't I think of that? Here's one of my created beings. Creating a principle. Where did it come from? That's good stuff. I could hit one down the middle with that one. Good stuff. Good stuff. Be a giver. Amen. Let's stand together. You're here today. And you've been drinking. I don't mean it. Or if you have, I don't know. You've been drinking from a cup. It's just not filling you up. Been drinking from a fountain. It's just not quenching the thirst. Been drinking from a fountain that when it's all over, you come back and you're the same way you were before you started. Let me give you another fountain to drink from. Drink from Him. Drink from the heavenly fountain. And your life will be changed from glory to glory, glory to glory. And everything will work out for you good, no matter where you are in the station of life you're in now. It'll go way, way, way beyond that. If you're here today, all you have to do is acknowledge who you really are. And when you do, you'll find you're not the person somebody else has said that you were. I want you to stand up here next to me. I want you to open that Bible. I want you to just kind of open it like this and thumb through it. I want you to point out there with it. Point, yeah, let people see it. Why don't you point out there? Just kind of flip through it. Just keep, yeah, keep flipping. Go to the new. Yeah, some good stuff. Go to the new. Hey, there we go. Let's flip some more. Let's flip some more. Hold it down where they can see. I got a reason for this. Keep flipping. Keep flipping. That's good. That's good stuff. Go flip a little more. Oh, yeah, that's, wow. Wow. This Bible is all marked up. All marked up with stuff. Because, JD, that's who you are. You're who God says you are, not what anybody else says you are. And God wants to remind you today, that's who you are. And about 3 years ago, I had boxes of tapes. We don't use them anymore, you know. And they were no good. And they were just taking up space. And so I was getting rid of these boxes of 30 years of sermons. And I was walking down the hall with them, take them. And I had tears flowing down my face. And I walked out. I took them to the dump. I came back. And I walked by Barbara's office. And she said, "Hey, come here." And I walked in her office. And she looked at me. And she said, "Dry that tear. Everything's in that tape. Don't mean nothing. It's all in you. It's all in you. And so don't worry about what physically you threw away. You can't throw this away. You can't take my spirit. You can't take my heart. You can't take that. God will give you something nobody can take away." As the elders are coming to remind ourselves again and again and again of who we are, let's come and take of this body and take of this blood to remember that's who we really are. Thank you. Spirit, you're welcome here. I want us to receive communion a little different way today. And I don't want you to wait on my instructions, but I want you to just listen and meditate, reflect on what she's saying, what she's singing. And let the Holy Spirit just become that real in you. And you just receive, take your bread when you want to and drink your cup when you want, Let's sing it. And you can even sing it with her. Worship. Thank you for being real to me, to us. Where you come and receive the offering. Thank you for residing and living in every person here. Thank you, God, that you don't dwell in temples made with hands, but in temples of men. Amen. You may be seated for a moment.
Type in Eagles Way Church, and this is what comes up. There are two pages right now that are on there, but if you go to the prayer request, you can, if that will come directly to an email here at the church, and put your prayer request in at the church. Or if you need to communicate it with us about something else, you can do that. It's just an email that is sent to us. The Bible app will take you to YouVersion Bible app. If you already have the Bible app downloaded, I would not take that off because you will. This only gives you the Bible. It doesn't give you all of your plans and all of those different things. But if you forgot to bring your actual Bible and you brought your phone, you brought your word with you. If you go to blog, Joey right now is the main one that is there. Dusty, we're going to challenge her to keep up a little bit more with Joey, but he's posting every day. But if you want to see or view to read Dusty and Joey's blogs, they are right there. Also, the email that comes out on a weekly basis from the church will be posted here as soon as we get that all done up. If you want to give, you can go to the Give button there. If you already have downloaded the PushPay app, you can eliminate that app now if you want to, because it is embedded there within the Eagles Way app if you want to do that. Go to the YouTube button. Those are all of the sermons. If you just want to view it right there on your phone, you can do that. If you want to AirPlay it to your TV at the house, you, those of you that know how to do that, can do that. You can go to the podcast, and if you want to just listen, podcast, YouTube, those are just fancy words for watching and listening. So if you aren't familiar with those, we'll get you familiar. But that's how that looks. Go to the second page. I think we're going to the second page. There we go. You have contact us. If you contact us, you can call us, you can email us, Facebook, Twitter, the website. You can access it all right there from that app. Find us. We'll take you to a Google map where you can, hopefully, if you're here today, you know where we're at. But you know what? If you share this with somebody else, they can find us. Say, hey, go to our app. It'll take you right to us. Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, all of the posts that we do. I kind of like, because I don't Facebook, but I can go see a Facebook post from Eagles Way. So that's really cool. And then the last one is the Right Now Media. Those of you that are utilizing the Right Now Media can access it straight from your phone. If you've not yet logged into Right Now Media, we'll give you access to be able to do that. So pretty cool, isn't it? That's very awesome. So I'm excited. I got to give kudos to Jason Brown. He is taking this thing and just run with it. He works on this kind of stuff like a hobby, like it's just fun for him. So, which is awesome. I like that aspect of it. So, you can still at this moment text the 77 or text Eagles Way Church to 77977, and that will send you a link to be able to download the PushPay app. Once you have signed up and if you want to give that way, you can. If you still want to drop your envelope with cash in it, you can do that. If you still want to write a check, you can do that. However you want to do, we're just trying to make it convenient and easy for you. I share some of those things because out at the pavilion, there will be a donation that will be taken for the meal today. Also, there's some new Being shirts that are now for sale, and they will be out there. And so if you want to give in such a way and you didn't bring cash, you can just download that app and do it that way. So thank you for your faithfulness in giving to the house of the Lord. We are touching people's lives throughout this community through our support of the food pantry, Spalding Samaritans. When you give, people's lives are touched. The alms that are giving, the tithes and the offerings all make a huge impact and huge difference. Father, Lord, we thank you, Lord, for this offering. Lord, thank you, Father, Lord, that for each and every dime that comes in, Father, Lord, that it's accounted for, Lord, that you will bless it, multiply it for the use of your kingdom. And I thank you for that. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. So we're going to dismiss here in just a second. We want you to head towards the pavilion. There's no rush. When you get there, just know that the pavilion has recently been sold.